Good evening. Over 100 years ago, the northern city of Manchester was very different. In 1889, Manchester ceased being a humble town and became a borough as more and more townships joined the metropolitan area. And in 1974, Manchester became a city. Manchester has seen two world wars, with World War II causing a lot of devastation. The biggest took place during the Christmas Blitz on the nights of the 22nd to the 24th of December 1940, when a large part of the historic city centre was destroyed. Yet, despite all of this, the Godley Observatory, which was a gift to Manchester by the philanthropist Francis Godley in 1902, still stands proud on the roof of the Municipal College of Technology, and the observatory remains in regular use by members of Manchester Astronomical Society. In July, I joined Vice President Kevin Kilburn and Public Relations Officer Anthony Cross at the Godley Observatory to learn more about this fascinating structure, before going on to Cheetham's Library to see the very rare Bevis Star Atlas. Today, Manchester City Centre improvements are underway, so that the noise was a slight problem during filming at the observatory. Even so, it was so worthwhile. Good afternoon. Behind me is Manchester University, and right up there, on the roof, is a Godley Observatory, which was donated to the City of Manchester by Francis Godley in 1902. I'm joined by Tony Cross, who's a senior member of Manchester Astronomical Society, who has kindly invited us along to take a look inside the building and see some of the telescopes. Welcome to the programme, Anthony.
And likewise, welcome to Manchester, Richard. It's a great pleasure to have you here, and especially to come and go into our beautiful old observatory, which we've had the pleasure of meeting there for many, many years. So why not come along with me now to meet our historian, Mr. Kevin Kilburn, who is waiting there to show you the goodies that's behind that great dome that you're seeing there. Thank you.
We are here in the dome of the Godley Observatory, and I am joined by Mr. Kevin Kilburn, who is the Vice President of Manchester Astronomical Society. Welcome to the programme, Kevin. Please can you tell us something about this magnificent structure?
The dome is a little bit unusual. The whole lot was supplied by Howard Grubb, so we're in the dome of the Godley Observatory here in the middle of Manchester, which, if you see it from the outside, is actually on a wooden tower suspended from the main fabric of the building, so it cantilevered out from the roof. So to keep the weight down, the whole building is made of wood, which has suffered. We've got to admit, over the past 100 years, It was renovated about 6 years ago, and the observatory itself is watertight. But at that time, as part of the renovation process, it was agreed to actually take the dome off and strip it back to its basics. And it was found that the inner lining of the dome, which looks like cardboard, is in fact made of papier-mâché. Now, the whole dome itself isn't made of papier-mâché. It's got an external cladding of, I think, of glass-reinforced plastic nowadays, but probably originally metal. But the inner lining, which looks like hardboard and looks as flaky as hardboard, is papier-mâché. And there are one or two samples that have been taken by the university about 8 years ago because they intended to replace the original materials. The money ran out, unfortunately, and the dome wasn't renovated. It's manually operated. There are ropes and pulleys that allow us to turn the dome around or to open the shutter back of me here. But 100 years has taken its toll, so we can get the shutter open, but it's a devil's own job to close it again. We'll try and work that one out later on. But in the meantime, the observatory has stood the test of time. As I said earlier, it's been in almost constant use since 1902. So for over 110 years, people have been able to use this observatory, and it's still in regular use.
That was really interesting. Please can you tell us something about the history of these splendid telescopes?
These are the Goddard telescopes. A donation to the city of Manchester in 1902 by Francis Goddard, who is a very rich calico manufacturer here in Manchester. And the telescopes and the observatory, the Goddard Observatory, cost them a grand total of £10,000. Multiply that by 50 to convert it to today's currency, and he paid £500,000 for this observatory out of his back pocket. He was a philanthropist, so if you wanted money for your library or public works or hospital or an observatory, ask him, and it said that his right hand didn't know what his left hand was doing. So this telescope was, all these telescopes were erected in 1902. They are the last of only four so-called twin equatorials built and designed by Howard Grubb Dublin. So we've got the name on the side here. And these are the only twin equatorials still in use today. There is another telescope, another twin, that Grubb built for Isaac Roberts, who was the president of the Liverpool Astronomical Society. He commissioned a 20-inch reflector counterbalancing a 7-inch refractor for photographic work. And that telescope is now on the roof of the Science Museum in London and is never used. In fact, it was used as a tea room, a sort of canteen for the staff. So this is the only twin equatorial that's been in use for over a century and is still in regular use today. Well, we've got two telescopes. It was designed to maximise the use of a small observatory. Although the telescopes were given to the City of Manchester, not to the Technical College, where we now are, it was part of the Physics Department of the Technical College from 1902 until about the Second World War. The telescopes are designed to do two different things. It's suggested that the refractor, the 8-inch refractor, was used for visual observations of the moon and planets. But the fact that Goddard also bought a micrometer for this instrument suggests it was also used for double star. So by measuring the position angle of double stars, you could do some basic astrophysics with a relatively modest telescope. If you could observe the colours of those stars with a spectroscope, and we've got a spectroscope given to the Society in 1903, you could do a little bit more astrophysics. So that's what that was used for. The 12-inch reflecting telescope was used for photography. And we know that because in 1902, after these telescopes were erected here, we have a photograph of the 12-inch telescope with a plate camera at the focus. So we know that that was used for deep sky work. To complement these two telescopes for wide field view of comets and star clusters, we've got a 6-inch F6 plate camera or half plate camera that could be used for wide angle photography. So we've got three instruments on one mounting, all designed to maximise use of a teaching observatory within a technical college. It used to be part of the physics department.
That's really interesting. Are these telescopes in regular use?
The reflector was, well, not quite sure whether it was an afterthought. The concept of a twin equatorial had its precedence with three other instruments built by Grubb. But when we actually look at the invoice that Grubb gave to the technical college, it doesn't have this on it. This is a 12-inch Newtonian reflector. We do know that he bought the mounting and that 8-inch refractor for £750. According to the 1903 catalogue, this 12-inch Newtonian reflector would cost another £250. But the other ancillary equipment was the plate camera, which would cost about £100, and the micrometer, which cost £30. So the whole telescopes at this level within the observatory cost approximately £1,250. Now, considering that the whole building cost £10,000, including the telescope, you can see that most of the cost of this facility went into the construction of the building, which is perhaps not unreasonable. But when you consider that for £1,250 multiplied by 50, so let's say about £25,000 in today's money, he got Grubb supplied to Francis Godley an 8-inch refractor, 12-inch reflector, and that camera for rather a lot of money by today's standards. You could equip a small observatory with better equipment nowadays. But of course, in those days, in 1902, although this wasn't state-of-the-art, it was built and constructed by one of the world's leading professional telescope makers. So you get what you pay for. The whole telescope has been here now for well over 100 years. Grubb himself actually lined the telescope, so this cast iron mountain, which stands on a massive concrete block extending down into the lower observatory, that had to be aligned, and it took 2 years just to do the polar aligning. So it was quite an investment in terms of cost to Godley and in terms of technical commitment by the technical college. Now, in this day and age, 2015, these telescopes are still owned by the university. Manchester Astronomical Society have got unlimited access to them as curators. But we have to respect the fact that these are not our instruments. In fact, of the instruments that we see here, the only one that is ours is this brass refractor, because this is a 5-inch ray refractor given to the society by one of our late members about 30 years ago, and this in its own right is quite a powerful instrument. We're using it nowadays as a guide scope or pointing scope for the 12-inch reflector. These are old instruments, old technology, but very robust technology. But to bring them up to date, about 6 years ago it was decided that the society would equip both telescopes with state-of-the-art Crayford focusers and a suite of eyepieces and camera accessories so that our members could use either the telescopes for photography, whether that be single photography using single lens reflex cameras, or for video photography using webcams or more sophisticated equipment. So we now have the facility for people wanting to observe, say, the moon, to observe through the 12-inch telescope using a video camera, which is connected to a laptop computer, normally kept here at the back of me, which in turn sends its information to a computer downstairs, which projects what the telescope sees for a collective audience. So on the Thursday night when we meet, if the weather's permitting, rather than queue up to use a refractor, we can collectively look at the objects that the telescopes are pointed at using video technology. So, quite state of the art.
Thank you, Kevin. Please can you tell us something about the background of Manchester Astronomical Society?
To give you the background to Manchester Astronomical Society, we've got to go back to 1859, when in the northwest of England, Leeds Astronomical Society was one of the first to be founded for amateurs. And uniquely at the time, Leeds Astronomical Society also admitted women. The Royal Astronomical Society didn't admit women until the 20th century. The thing about Leeds was that it was a relatively expensive society to run, and unfortunately it priced itself out of the market. So within a few years it went into abeyance. That society is active nowadays, but in the 1860s it did go into hiatus for several years. Now in 1881, Liverpool Astronomical Society was founded, and that was so successful that by 1890 it also went bankrupt, because it was costing so much to actually send current notes or communications to its 3,000 members that it ran out of money. But because of the structure of the Liverpool Astronomical Society, structured around observing sections, so there was a solar section, a lunar section, coloured star section, etc., it was decided that there should be a national society founded along the same lines. And this is why in 1890 the British Astronomical Association came into being. That was also active in the Northwest, because there were members still from Liverpool Astronomical Society living in the area. So Edward Maunder, he of Maunder Minimum fame, contacted one of the members living in Manchester and suggested that there should be a northwestern branch of the BAA set up based here in Manchester. Now this came about in 1892, but for several years it was a peripatetic society meeting in coffee houses and various premises within the city, and it wasn't until November the 5th, 1902, by which time we'd had a sort of an involvement with the recommendations for the Coley telescopes, what sort of instruments would be useful for the college, that our members were invited to come to the observatory, say November 5th, 1902, to inspect the telescopes. And at that point, it was realised that the canny members of the Northwestern branch, rather than pay their subscriptions, or much of their subscriptions, to a BA in London, would be better off if they founded their own society. So in 1903 there was a change of name, and the Manchester Astronomical Society came into being as a standalone Northwestern society. By then Liverpool was back up and running, so was Leeds, so Manchester took its rightful place as one of the three big Northwestern astronomical societies, one of the original big three Victorian societies, although technically I suppose Manchester is actually an Edwardian society. But we didn't have access to the Godley Observatory. As I mentioned before, the observatory was part of the technical college, although given to the people of Manchester. So we had irregular access to the observatory by permission with the college. For the early 30 years of 20th century, our secretary, W.C. Jenkins, was the curator of the observatory on behalf of the physics department here. So he would arrange occasional visits to the observatory by the MAS members, but we certainly didn't have unlimited access as we do nowadays.
We have now walked about a mile away from the Godley Observatory, and here is Chiffin's Library in Manchester city centre. This building was in existence back in the 15th century, and it's here that Manchester Astronomical Society have their most prized possession, a Bevis Star Atlas. Kevin Kilburn and Anthony Cross are waiting for us inside to tell us more about its fascinating history.
We're here in Cheetham's Library in the heart of Manchester. It's a very, very ancient library, the oldest lending library in the English-speaking world. And for nearly 18 years, it's been home of this atlas, John Beavis's Atlas Celeste, that in November 1997, we discovered in the library of the Manchester Astronomical Society in the Godley Observatory. Tony Cross, myself, and one of our friends, Michael Oates, had gone to the observatory that November night to observe an occultation of Saturn by the moon. Everything was going well. It got to nearly the time of the occultation when, unfortunately, typical Manchester weather, it clouded over, and within an hour it had started to rain. I came down, having closed the observatory that night, to find that Tony Cross was showing this atlas to Mike Oates. But what we didn't realise at the time was just how scarce an object we'd found. To appreciate that, it's necessary to read out this section, which is the part of the frontispiece of the atlas. And when that's read out, you appreciate just what a rare find we'd actually discovered. We knew that we had an old star atlas. It was mentioned in the 1930s in one of our minute books, but then it was regarded as being so old-fashioned it was neither use nor ornament to modern astronomers. But what really set the story that night back in 1997 was when we read this introduction to what we'd found. It says, Atlas Celeste, or the Celestial Atlas, being the most correct, copious, and superb work of the kind that has ever been offered to the public. The expense of the engravings was immense, as the most capital artists in Europe were employed in executing them, and the learned and ingenious delineators and directors of the work had determined to sell it by way of subscription at 5 guineas a set. The heavy charge attending it rendered some of them insolvent. Others were removed by death, which, with diverse adverse occurrences, were the means of retarding the publication until the present period, 1786. Many of the copies have been destroyed by fire and removals. The few that remain are now offered at 1.5 guineas each set. Now, this is the interesting bit. This elegant and useful work is not, nor ever has been, in the hands of any bookseller. The copies saved are all of the first impression and will be an ornament to any library and highly worthy the notice and patronage of every lover of the scientists. That night, we went home Mike Oates took this atlas home in a bin liner and contacted Peter Hingley, the late librarian at the Royal Astronomical Society. And Peter said, "What we think you've got is a Beavis star atlas." That being the case, when we discovered this back in 1997, only 16 copies were known in the world. We just discovered the 17th. What I've just read out might be considered to be an advert. Somebody in 1786 wanted to sell off cheap these atlases. But what was this atlas? Clearly it was going to be important. We have on the frontispiece a royal figure. This is probably Frederick, Prince of Wales, being offered a star atlas by the muse Urania. There's the atlas. We've got the other muses of literature and geometry and music standing around the throne, and you can actually see the feathers of the Prince of Wales at the back. So we know that this wasn't the king. We're pretty sure it was Frederick, Prince of Wales. The date suggests it's round about 1750. We've got Greenwich Observatory here in the background. And when we look at the individual star charts, we find that they are all, as it says in the advert, all of the first impression. You can actually see the impression of the copper plates here at the corners. All these plates, and there are 51 of them, are dedicated to individual people who actually subscribed to the original version. But what was the original version going to be? This has got no text in it whatsoever. And we were fortunate in that in 1981, an American professor at the University of Kansas City, a gentleman called Ashworth, had written about an atlas like this that is now owned by the American Philosophical Society in Philadelphia. And he'd learned that this was an intended atlas by an English doctor, a London doctor, called John Beavis. Now, John Beavis was born in 1695. He was well connected at Greenwich. He knew the Astronomer Royal on intimate terms. In fact, he was actually offered the job of Astronomer Royal later in his life. But he decided that it was time for a very, very good star atlas to be produced. Flamsteed himself had produced a star atlas based on his observations from Greenwich. That was published in 1729. And Beavis wanted to improve on that. So he had these very elaborate plates done by the best craftsmen in Europe, probably in Denmark, in Holland. He paid for the plates to be done by subscription that was collected from quite a lot of people in the UK, not royalty, but certainly landed gentry. And he produced this superb atlas that was going to be called Urania Britannica, the Great British Star Atlas. He intended each of the plates to be faced by, on this side, by a document actually describing the stars on the page opposite. But as you see from this, there aren't any descriptive notes. The reason for that is that the atlas was being financed by subscription, and that subscription was being collected by a London globe maker called John Neal. And in 1750, just as the atlas was about to be offered to the public, John Neal went bankrupt. The copper plates that had printed this atlas were sequestered by the London Courts of Chancery. The project was dead in the water. Beavis's atlas, what he wanted to be called the Great British Atlas, Urania Britannica, was never published. So in 1997, when we found this, what exactly had we found? Well, the stories have unfolded since 1997, and I can now tell you that records show, documentary evidence shows, that in 1785, long after John Beavis had died — he apparently died when he was observing the sun, he fell off his ladder — long after John Neal had died, somebody, and we don't know who, managed to get hold of pre-printed plates, clapped them together, bound them, and offered them for sale cheap under the title Atlas Celeste. So what we've got here isn't Urinographia Britannica, because it doesn't have the descriptive notes. We've got an original Atlas Celeste dating to 1786. We don't know how it got into the collection of Manchester Astronomical Society, but this atlas, this very atlas, is so rare that we know of only 29 in the world. By comparison, the next rarest star atlas is Bayer's Urinometria, published in Augsburg in 1603, and there are 125 copies of that known throughout the world. I've been researching this with American professor Jay Pasikoff since 2003, and to date we've only managed to find 29, and this atlas is the best of those 29. In August last year, 2014, on the Great British Antiques Map of Britain, it was valued at between 25 and £30,000, but it was expected at auction to fetch as much as £35,000. This is not only rare, it's extremely valuable, and that's why we have to keep it here at Cheetham's. There are 52 plates in Atlas Celeste, and indeed in the original version, Urinographia Britannica. But this is my favourite. It depicts Taurus the bull. But what's peculiar about this particular print is that this atlas was the first to show what we now call deep sky objects. So for the very first time, it depicts what was to be known as M1, Messier 1, the Crab Nebula. Beavis himself, not Messier, discovered M1. He discovered it in 1738. Messier didn't list it for another 20 years. But there we are, we've got the Crab Nebula. The other interesting thing is that Beavis was using Flamsteed's original catalogue, published in 1719. And Flamsteed, as the first astronomer royal, his job was to catalogue the positions of all the stars visible from Greenwich. So he was systematically observing stars as they transited the meridian at Greenwich, logging them in a notebook so that he could produce his own atlas in 1729. It was actually produced posthumously. Beavis was using the same notes, but bringing it forward to the epoch 1745. So all the stars in slightly different positions with respect to the grid, which is the ecliptic. Here we've got the zodiac, the zodiacal constellation of Taurus the bull, which you can see the depiction is beautiful. But because Beavis wasn't observing himself, he was actually using Flamsteed's notes. What he didn't know is that there's an extra star on this chart. Unbeknown to Beavis and unbeknown to Flamsteed, that star is the first ever recorded observation of the planet Uranus. Now, Uranus itself wasn't discovered until 1781 by William Herschel in Bath, but of course it was still in the sky. And there we are, 1699, and published in 1750, a depiction of Uranus as a star. That star isn't there now. But it begs the question, did Beavis also observe Uranus when he was putting together a catalogue for about an additional 1,000 stars during the period 1738-1739. He actually observed for exactly 1 year, 6th of March 1738 to 6th of March 1739, from his home in North London to produce his atlas. So although we've got a pre-discovery observation of Uranus, it begs the question, could Beavis also have observed Uranus during the year 1738 to 1739? Where would Uranus have been by then? Well, if we move forward to the constellation of Sagittarius, we know that Beavis's atlas was the first to record deep sky objects, and here in Sagittarius we've got two more messier objects depicted as fuzzy blobs. So where was Uranus during that year, 1738? Well, it turns out that during June and July 1738, Uranus retrograded along the ecliptic just about there. There are two groups of stars shown here. One of them has got an extra star in this atlas. It's almost certainly another pre-discovery observation of Uranus, this time by Beavis. Nowadays, you look at that part of the sky, there's a star missing. That is Uranus. As well as depicting deep sky objects, Beavis also depicted what he called extinct stars. Now, we're not quite sure what he meant by that, but this depiction of the constellation of Cassiopeia shed some light on what he had in mind. This very, very bright star doesn't appear in the heavens today. What he's depicted there is the supernova of 1671, so-called Tycho's star. This was a nova that was seen to explode in November of that year by Tycho Brahe, and it was followed for about not quite 2 years as it slowly faded. This was a supernova. There are other stars depicted, these Beavis's extinct stars, which might depict what we would call ordinary novae. They appear for a few weeks in the sky and then fade. Perhaps Beavis thought they might come back. That's why he depicted them on his atlas. But let's consider the atlas as a whole. I've called it two things. I've called it Uranographia Britannica, and I've called it Atlas Celeste. What's the difference? Well, in 1785, Beavis's executor, James Horsfall, died, and his wife put Beavis's library up for auction, together with, we can presume, these copper plates and three almost finished Uranographia Britannica. So we know there were three nearly finished atlases, including the descriptions, at that sale, at that auction in 1785. The one that went to America in the mid-19th century, which is now in Philadelphia, is one of these complete Uranographias. There is a very poor quality atlas in St. John's Library in Cambridge. That is also a Uranographia, because it's got the notes to accompany the star charts. Until 2011, the third Uranographia was missing. And then in the autumn of that year, I went to Chatsworth, and a friend of mine pointed out that there used to be a scientist involved with Chatsworth, a chap called Henry Cavendish. And Henry Cavendish's father, one of the Dukes of Devonshire, was actually listed as one of the contributors to the financing of Uranographia Britannica, but died before it could be published. I contacted the library at Chatsworth to ask if they had a Beavis Atlas. They had. And I went over there on the 11th of November 2011. And like this one is presented here, their atlas was put in front of me. And I opened the first page and the star chart was there, but there wasn't any descriptive notes. I turned over another page. Star charts were there, there weren't any notes. Turned over the third page, and not only did we have the star charts, but we had descriptive notes. What I'd not discovered is a wrong word. What I'd identified, and Chatsworth librarians didn't realise this, I'd managed to identify the missing Urinographia Britannica. So we now know exactly where the three Urinographia Britannicas listed in the auction catalogue in 1785 are. There's one in Philadelphia, that's the best. The second best in the world is at Chatsworth. And the third and poor quality one is at St John's Library in Cambridge. So we know where the three missing, or where the three Urinographias are. But we still don't know how many atlas lists were put together. Jay Pasikoff and I have identified 29. They're split roughly evenly between about a dozen in the UK, normally in various libraries and institutions because they are so very, very valuable, and a similar number in America, owned by universities, large libraries, like the library in Detroit, and wealthy individuals. They occasionally come up for sale, and the auction houses such as Sotheby's and Christie's are on the lookout and advise me if any of these atlases turn up, because then I can add them to the list that's kept on the website of Manchester Astronomical Society. There are only two other atlases outside of the UK or America. One is in Sweden at the University of Uppsala, and one is in Melbourne, Australia. We're not sure how that got there, but that's also one of these atlases. So 29 worldwide, exceedingly rare, exceedingly valuable by normal standards for a collection of an ordinary astronomical society like that of Manchester, but an artifact that we're very, very proud of. And so is the city of Manchester. This is why in the late 1990s, when we wanted to find a safe, secure home for this atlas, we offered it to both Ryland's Library of Manchester University and to here at Cheetham's. And very kindly, Dr. Michael Powell, the head librarian, chief librarian here at Cheetham's, suggested that they would keep it safe for us. So, in a nutshell, that's the story of our discovery back in 1997. I'm still researching it. I'm giving a talk shortly in London about this atlas with Professor Pasikoff. But in the meantime, we still don't know who that anonymous bookseller was in 1786. If anybody watching this programme can trace him, I suspect it might have been John Neill's son, because he obviously knew the history of the atlas. But he wasn't allowed, none of them were allowed to actually benefit by the sale before the actual auction of the atlas in 1785. It would have, Neill was bankrupt, he wasn't allowed to make money from the sale of it. But in 1786, obviously somebody did. Not a lot. It says in the beginning, in the start here, that this atlas should have been offered for 5 guineas a set. He got that bit wrong. It was only going to be 2.5 guineas a set. He was trying to make money. But if this was sold, if this atlas was sold for 1.5 guineas a set in 1786, then it's gone up in value just a bit since then. Let's just go back now. We've identified the location of the three Urinographia Britannicas from that auction catalogue of 1785. We've identified 29 of we don't know how many Atlas Celestes that were sold in 1786. But that auction catalogue contains two other items. Whilst this atlas was in the process of being printed, before it was actually finished, prints were taken from the copper plates to see what the condition was like of the engraving. And in 1785, two sets of proof plates were listed. We know that one of them, or a number of proof plates, proof prints I should say, were bound into the Atlas Celeste that now exists in the British Library. That incidentally isn't the best in the world, this one is. The reason that the British Library copy isn't the best is that it's been folded in half, probably 2 centuries ago, but it's not in its original format. But within that copy of Atlas Celeste in the British Library are some plates that don't contain the dedications. The plates are only being tested. But there's another set of proof plates missing. And 2 years ago, I was asked by the London Science Museum to have a look at an atlas that had been identified as a Flamsteed Atlas, because they weren't sure what it was. Now, it wasn't at the Science Museum in London. It was actually in their Overspill collection just outside Swindon. So I was invited to go down to Swindon to have a look at this Flamsteed Atlas. I opened it up and immediately recognised it was a book full of 38 proof prints from Beavis's Atlas. Most of the plates hadn't been completed, some hadn't the dedications, some hadn't got these lines, some hadn't got the zodiac printed on them. They've got some stars, there were actual patches of some of the star depictions that had no stars on them. But that collection down in Swindon, owned by the Science Museum, is again a missing item from that 1785 auction catalogue. So we've now identified everything that was on that auction catalogue. We've got the 3 Uranographia Britannicas, we've got 29 of an unknown number of Atlas Celestes. As you go down the list of known Atlas Celestes, they get less and less complete. So most start off with 52 plates and an index. Some finish up with 48 plates, some only 42 plates. So they're obviously getting less complete as the seller in 1786 was running out of star charts. And we have the two sets of proof prints. We've got the one at Swindon and we've got the one in the Atlas Celeste in the British Library. We've now identified all of what has been termed the Forgotten Star Atlas. Oh, one final thing before I go. Because this atlas has proved to be so popular by the general public, it was decided about 15 years ago that Manchester Astronomical Society should actually make a CD, subsequently a DVD, depicting all these plates. This is available through the Manchester Astronomical Society website. A very modest cost, but it helps us to finance this ongoing research. Thank you.
That was fascinating. If you would like a copy of the Beavis Star Atlas on a DVD, please go to the Manchester Astronomical Society website and the link is shown here. That is all we have time for this month. Please visit our website, Vimeo, where you may watch all of the past shows of astronomy and space. And if you like this programme, please share it with your friends and members of your local astronomical society. Until we come back next month, good evening.